Welcome to Spooky History. In this episode, we're spending some final seasonal fun with the Welsh Mari Lwyd. Lwyd. This is going to be another one of those Ash can't pronounce things episodes, isn't it? Thanks, RH. Roll credits. It's that time of year to treat the scales like hot coals and scoff the last of the mince pies. When the booze cabinet is still half full and you somehow have to finish all that brandy double cream in the fridge or it'll go off tomorrow. That time you tell yourself calories take a break and go on holiday. Your body will have mercy and let you fit into those gorgeous new clothes from Santa, because it's Christmas. Or that obscure time between then and New Year, when you never quite know what the hell day it is. And before I forget, you're in Wales. Mulled wine, champagne, brandy, beer, and more is still pumping through your system, hence more mince pies to soak it all up, perfectly reasonable. Your bloody kids playing the 100 greatest Christmas hits on loop for the billionth time. You're excited and knackered and stuffed and happy and burping and dizzy and woozy and drunk and hungover all at once. Then there's an odd sound at the door, like someone's rapping it with a poker. The festive garden lights sparkle off some indiscernible shapes outside, singing something or other. With a sigh, you heave your overfed body off the couch, stumbling over toys and wrapping paper to get to the door. You've grown up with Santa Claus, Cliff Richard, tinsel, holly, stockings, candy canes, white angels and those paper-cut snowflakes that they made you stick to the windows in primary school. You've even seen a Krampus keyring, drunken carol singers, and an elf kissogram who'd got the wrong house. Though as this video is being made in the year of COVID, any house is the wrong house for a kissogram, elf or otherwise. Nothing, however, has quite prepared you for the sight greeting you now. The first thing you register, and will never forget, is being nose to nose with a hideous pearly white horse's skull. Its dead glass eyes stare right back into yours. The skull is adorned with ribbons stuck on top of a long pole, held up by some dude underneath, both hidden by a huge white sheet. You gasp as its jaws open and close by some string or lever. Clap chomp, clap chomp. Ever been bitten by a horse? I don't advise trying it. I once saw what it can do to another. An entire chunk had been ripped out from a horse's nose, and you could clearly see a ridge of white bone. But moving on. This monstrosity is not alone. Like Christmas's answer to the world's creepiest geysers, 4 to 7 people stand before you, dressed in rosettes and sashes. Merry men, musicians, playing instruments. Punch stands there with a fire poker, drumming out the rhythm on your doorstep, as you hasten to close the door. His wife Judy blocks it with a broom, already brushing your threshold. Giggity giggity. And leading this whole troop, a tall figure dressed as a sinister gentleman with a staff in his hand. Giggity giggity. Now I don't know about you, but personally, if that were me answering the door, I'd blink, probably more than once, and vow never to drink any alcohol ever again. What the hell have my in-laws spiked me with? But before the what the fuck has gotten past your lips, things are about to turn weirder. You get sang at. Well, here we come, innocent friends, to ask to leave, to ask to leave, to ask to leave, to sing. The wonderful writer of these scripts actually provided the lyrics in Welsh. That was optimistic of her. Still, better than being Whamageddoned, if you ask me. They request entry to your household, then pause, because you see there's protocol to follow here. You have to sing back, making excuses for denying admission. Go on, give it a go. Humour them. You're going to lose, by the way. You realise that. And suffer, maybe even enjoy the consequences. This musical duel repeats back and forth until finally you either give in or run out of excuses. Uh-oh, you're out of smart-ass melodic retaliations. Nice try, Pavarotti. Stand aside. Your peaceful household is about to be gatecrashed by the Mari Lwyd. In case you thought your living room wasn't messy enough, wait till this lot come literally crashing in. Hobby horse skulls bounds about, neighing and causing mayhem. The merry men go to town with their instruments and dancing. Gentlemanly leader puts on a mock show of unsuccessfully trying to calm things. And watch out for Mr. Punch. He'll put out your cozy fire with that poker unless you make him swear not to. He's always been a tricky one. On the bright side, though, this Advent's answer to crazy geysers have certainly helped you polish off all those excess turkey sandwiches, booze and mince pies. Many hands of the community went into building that impressive horse skull outfit, if not a real skull, then papier-mâché or wood. What we have here is a Welsh festive winter event starting at dusk, ending in the wee small hours of the morning, performed during Christmas and New Year period, though specific days varied depending on the village, with no hard and fast rule whether they went on for one night or several. According to historian E.C. Court, in the Gower Peninsula of southwest Wales, the same horse's head was used repeatedly each year but buried for the remainder. But Mari Lwyd, what does that name mean? Christian interpretations of the name include Blessed Mary or Holy Mary. There's a problem here though. It is argued that the name Mari, for Mary, wasn't recognised in Wales until the 1500s. Furthermore, Lwyd is the Welsh for grey, hence others believe Mari Lwyd translates into grey mare. The jury's still out on that one. Nor does the debate seem to end surrounding the origins of this horse's skull I've yet to see on Christmas cards, though damn I wish it was. Basically because in truth Mari Lwyd was not officially recorded in Wales until the 1800s. We appear to have yet another Christian versus pre-Christian tug of war here, with both sides trying to claim cultural ownership. Some folklorists even suggest a compromise by overlapping the two. For starters, you've got the argument that its origins lie in a purely Christian celebration called, wait for it, the Feast of the Ass. Funny how you never see that on signs outside church doors. It'd certainly make a change from try praying. But before we steer dangerously off topic here, we're talking donkeys, not rimming, with said feast referring to Mary and Joseph fleeing to Egypt. Or inspired by a pre-Christian wassailing tradition, British in origin, which by the Middle Ages was renamed after the Virgin Mary. Others argue Mari Lwyd was influenced by mystery plays, essentially Bible-based performances practiced across medieval Europe. On the other hand, some believe it symbolises a death horse, further emphasised by the white cloth adorning its wearer, hence part of the pre-Christian Samhain festivities, or even as a fertility symbol. However, considering the relatively recent emergence of Mari Lwyd in the 1800s, what's more likely is this was a variation on ancient traditions not uncommon in the British Isles. Considering how strikingly similar it is to wassailing, it isn't really an original tradition in its own right, but more a variation or combination of seasonal celebrations across Britain. Consider the star of the show here, a hooded horse, strikingly similar to a hobby horse, a popular figure in British folklore, which doesn't pop up in documented history until the 1500s and 1600s, along with England's Morris dancers. Let's look at a few examples. The hobby horse, no stranger to Christmas and New Year celebrations, often with a team of revellers in costume demanding payment or tribute from people. East Kent, England. The hoodening. A wooden, aka hooden, hobby horse is mounted on a pole and carried by a man hidden under a cloth. Derbyshire in Yorkshire, Auld Tup. A hobby horse with a goat's head accompanied by revellers knocking on doors again at Christmas. South West England, hobby horse festivals on May Day known as the Padstow, Obby, Oss and Minehead hobby horse festivals. In Cornwall, for instance, the Penglass, meaning grey head, raises its dead head on St John's Eve, the 23rd of June, but it's otherwise almost identical to the Mari Lwyd, made of wood or a real horse's skull and joined by merrymakers guising about the houses. It looks like Wales took these traditions and made its own special figure. Fair play, too. Mari Lwyd was most often done in Glamorgan, before spreading to Monmouthshire and Carmarthenshire. Its earliest recorded account was in 1800 by author J. Evans. A man on New Year's Day dressing himself in blankets and other trappings with a factitious head like a horse and a party attending him, knocking for admittance. Thus obtained, he runs about the room with an uncommon frightful noise, which the company quit in real or pretending fright. They soon recover and by reciting a verse of some Welsh poetry, or in default, paying a small gratuity, they gain admission. It was later elaborated that the Mari Lwyd party performed this custom from Christmas Day until the 12th day after. At first glance, to our 21st century eyes, Mari Lwyd appears to literally be a deliberate form of harassment, these revellers refusing to piss off until the hapless homeowners gave them food or cash. But take a moment here. Winter in South Wales, when there really were winters, and by that I mean lots of snow. They weren't easy in remote rural communities, including, for instance, local farmers who didn't get to see a lot of folk, especially in tough winter conditions. Far from making Mari Lwyd a public menace, this instead served to strengthen community feeling and contact between neighbours. It wouldn't surprise me if at some point Mari Lwyd had inadvertently saved someone's life who was dying from hypothermia or some other seasonal illness. An approved means of entering houses in a culture in which there were few public assemblies, at least in the heart of winter, in which the convivial spirit of the season could be released. But these were also changing times. The Industrial Revolution was coming, rail tracks would soon carve their way through the fields, society was about to change forever, and this would affect everyone, Christmas celebrations being no exception. And so the tradition started slipping into decline. But that wasn't the only reason. Yes, yes, come all ye faithful party poopers, step forward. In the words of Baptist minister Blenow Gwent, the Welsh Methodist revival was just what the sinful pagan and popish bunch needed. I wish of this and all similar follies that they find no place anywhere apart from the Museum of the Historian and Antiquity. Boo! It wouldn't be the first nor last example of attempted cultural cleansing. It had already been going on there for some time, it seems, since long before then. In 1802, harpist Edward Jones did not hold back on how much fun the Methodist Church was taking out of old Welsh festivities. Wales, which was formerly one of the merriest and happiest countries in the world, is now becoming one of the dullest. But fear not, ye heathens, the party's not over till the grey mare sings. By the 20th century, the Mari Lwyd began experiencing a revival, from being observed by chance on Christmas Eve in Swansea, to the 50s and 60s, where it was annually performed near Cowbridge for 60 years by a particularly dedicated local. And those were just the ones we know about. I'm personally of the opinion that it never died out to begin with, it just stayed off the church's radar. Because by the 1970s, some villages in South Wales were at it again, and by the 80s people were complaining if Mari Lwyd missed their house. In 2000, in supreme spirit, Aberystwyth let rip and created the world's largest Mari Lwyd, with wassailing galore. Indeed, it now appears to have come back with a mighty vengeance. Mari Lwyd, Mari Lwyd, a sacred thing through the night they carry, betrayed the living, betrayed the dead, all are confused by a horse's head. I hope you enjoyed that episode. You can find us on most social media at SpookyHistShow, and if you want to support us, you can donate at paypal.me/noisyghostent. Thanks for watching, and please, do have nightmares. Goodbye.